2,000 years ago, when the Romans invaded this particular area of Holland, the Mersaki tribe lived along its coast as well. This proud tribe had already occupied this land for many years, and they lived behind high sand banks and dune islands that ran along the coast of Zeeland and along borders of three great rivers, the Skeld, the Maas, and the Rhine. These three great rivers wound their way through several lands before finally spilling into the Helle, which is today called the North Sea. For the Mersaki, there was no shortage of food, not while living beside such great waterways, with traders sailing in from many lands to exchange their goods for the much sought-after merchandise of the Mersaki, namely fine cloth of dyed sheep wool, farming produce, and fish. In this way, the Mersaki acquired bronze and iron tools and weapons, wine, pottery, and jewelry from distant lands and cultures. And because Mother Nature was kind to the tribal folk, they worshipped the Earth Goddess in return. And she let herself be seen in visions and dreams that the priestess conjured up by gazing into a spectacular, light-giving crystal ball. And often, the Earth Goddess appeared in three shapes. And one of them was a goddess with a beautiful name, Nehalennia. For this reason, the special crystal ball was called the Eye of Nehalennia. This magic crystal could only be used in very special circumstances, and only the priestesses knew where to go to get this mysterious glowing ball. No one knew for sure, but it was long rumored that this light-giving crystal came from the sea and was guarded by a beautiful red-haired mermaid, who perhaps was the daughter of Nehalennia herself. All this kept the people in awe and admiration of the goddesses, whom they looked to for fortune and guidance. The Mersaki believed that their goddess bestowed an abundance of food on them, giving them fish, birds, wild swine, and deer from the forest. And she also gave them rich harvests of grain and fruit that year after year the Mersaki people enjoyed. Nehalennia also saw to it that people who sailed the sea safely reached their destination. She did this in her own special way, by lighting up the sea on certain nights, so seafarers would not run adrift on the treacherous sandbanks along the coast. The driving sea and breaking waves appeared magical, as if the water had been changed into silver liquid moonlight, to show seafarers the way to the harbors. In fact, Nehalennia means the light of the sea. And is this not a fitting name for the daughter of the sea god with a magical and dangerous razor-sharp trident? It was also reassuring when Nehalennia's light lit up the sea, because then all the malevolent spirits who were forever looking to do harm would keep away. And Slokop, the three-headed sea dragon, would creep even deeper into her lair on the seabed and chew nervously on old bones while listening to the cries of whales and dolphins up above, creatures which made her feel very uneasy. But whenever Nehalennia's light did not shine, Slokop swam to the surface to attack stranded ships loaded with tasty fish soup and barrels of sweet wine. But now and again, she'd make a mistake and sink her three-headed fangs into a ship full of earthenware or salt. And this, of course, was painful for her stomach. And then she'd have to rest out for a few weeks to recover. The traveling storytellers that knew all the old stories told that very long ago, three priestesses were changed into this three-headed sea monster. They had tried to use their power and knowledge to enchant and mislead the people, and had even tried to steal her three-fourth trident from the sea god. In order to cast their spells, they intended to abuse the special light-giving crystal ball. But one of them had used the wrong spell, and ping! In a puff of smoke, the three of them were changed into Slokop with the three heads. From that moment on, they had to live out their lives in hatred, forever burdened with the prospect of having to look at one another's horrendous heads and have fights over nothing almost every day. So instead of fooling their own people and the sea god, they ended up punishing themselves and had to dive away whenever Nehalennia's light brightened the sea and the beaches and sandbanks. And so it follows that the Marsaki people were very thankful to Nehalennia for her generous gifts and protection. And like every tribe, they had a bard that honored the goddess with stories, poetry, and music. If a bard was really good and did not sing out of tune and played well on his harp and flute, then the sandbanks would be full of mermaids and seals. So enchanted with the music were they that they lay in the sand all day, mesmerized by the sweet melodies and sounds.